Thank you. My name is Kuleba David. I come from Uganda. I work with an organization called NAPE, in which is the National Association of Professional Environmentalists, also Friends of the Earth Uganda. We work in collaboration with Global Forest Coalition. My expertise, I'm an environmentalist, and at the organization, I coordinate forest and biodiversity.
Could you please give us some more information about what's going on with deforestation on the world?
Yeah, thank you. When you look at, for example, in my country where I come from, Uganda, one of the biggest challenges is that there is a lot of promotion of agribusinesses, talk about agrofuels or oil palm growing at the expense of natural forests and at the expense of community rights. You realize that if communities that have been dependent on the forest and the forest is given away to a corporation, it means that the livelihood is gone. And like many other colleagues of mine mentioned, forests are the lungs of this world. If the forests are destroyed, what then happens? It therefore means that the microclimate is going to be tampered with. It means that the food basket is going to also be tampered with for communities. It means that even in terms of medication, communities will not get medicine that they used to get. It means that the small microbes, because we are talking about agrochemical use in some of these plantations, it means the small microbes will be killed. It means that pollinators will be killed. And as a consequence, the Mother Earth will be harmed. Yes.
Can we imagine what could happen if we do not have forests at all on the world?
Would not have life.
We couldn't.
Would not have life. Because, for example, if you look at, there is a lady who made a presentation in the morning here. What we take in is not necessarily produced by us. It is plants that produce oxygen, and we give them carbon dioxide. So if plants do not exist, if forests were not there, it means we would not have life. Because if we didn't have oxygen, how would we survive? We would not have life at all.
And what could happen to the Mother Earth? Yeah, we, human, we could die. What could happen to Mother Earth if we keep the forest state in this way?
And actually, I want to put this one very clear, that with Mother Earth, it has its way of regulating people. If we actually make it very unhappy, it will penalize us. Because we have seen floods, you have seen so many catastrophes. We think that we are harming Mother Earth, but we are harming our own selves. There is no way the Mother Earth will be harmed and it doesn't retaliate. It will pay back. Yeah, so that is it. In as long as we don't, actually what we should be doing should be for the survival of our own selves. But in as long as we think that we are harming the environment by destroying forests, by destroying wetlands, by destroying all these fragile ecosystems, then we are destroying our own lives.
Do as a humanity, do we have any alternative?
Yes. Our ancestors used to manage these forests, like this people you saw here. They are very good managers of forests. So we need to transfer power from the corporates. Let the communities be in charge of forests. Communities can better manage forests than the governments. Because if you look at the resources that are held in trust for the people, eventually it is not held in trust for the people. They end up being held in trust for the corporations, for their own interest, for their own greed. So we need people power to own some of these resources. We need, if we're talking about, for example, rejuvenation, if we're talking about rehabilitation of these forests, we need to use the indigenous species. Not, for example, in my country, where pine, eucalyptus, and all these commercial trees are introduced, at the end of it, when they are cleared, then you're harming the Mother Earth. We need those indigenous trees that can keep the cycle of the breathing system, of inorganic formation, of photosynthesis.
Do you know any concrete and real experience of some communities or indigenous communities, the way they work with forests and they conserve forests? Do you know any experience?
Yeah, Mabira Forest is one of them. I'm talking from experience of the country where I come from. Communities have that collaborative forest management system. They're in charge of forest. So in case of anything, they are the ones that take charge. If take an example of fires, it is the communities that can protect the fire other than the rest of the other people before they come in. If you're talking about issues of any other encroacher, because oftentimes these forests are encroached upon, but it is a community person in the neighborhood that can see a person entering the forest. So I think people, like you asked, Mabira Forest is one of them. And if I can give you an example, when the government attempted to give it away, to one of the sugar growing corporations. They resisted. They resisted. They demonstrated. We had to lose lives, of course. And like I said, that's how Mother Earth retaliates. We lost lives, but the forest was conserved, was saved.
Could you please ask mention who is accountable for this?
Sorry?
Who's accountable? Who's the responsibility for?
Largely, it is the government that is accountable for all this, because it's the government that gives concessions without consulting the owners of resources, because the resources are for the communities, and communities are never consulted. So it is the government which is primarily responsible for all these challenges. And the, of course, if you're talking about the corporations that are given leases, also they are also in charge, because they're supposed to be developing some of these projects, or some of the land that is encumbrance free. But oftentimes, even when communities resist, they go ahead and develop, meaning that they're also in charge. So it is a collaboration of government and corporations.
Okay. David, thank you so much for your helping.
You're most welcome.